Hello everyone, my name's Tori. I'm a professional freediver, and I've experienced my fair share of highs and brutal lows. In this video, I'm going to tell you why it's better to breathe your oxygen through a regulator rather than an oxygen mask. I'm also going to tell you why it's better to breathe your oxygen in the water rather than out. These decisions can have critical implications and even more critical outcomes. It could be the difference between hours, days, weeks, months, or even years of recovery. What I tell you in this video can make all the difference. Here's the deal though. I'm gonna give you my experience on these very unique topics. You get to make your own better informed decisions based on that. Oxygen. It's the first thing you think about when something goes wrong underwater, but how you take it and where can make all the difference. Imagine this, you surface from a dive, your head feels heavy, you feel dizzy, you know something's not right. Do you stay floating in the water or do you climb onto the boat? Do you grab an oxygen mask or do you grab an oxygen regulator to receive your oxygen? A regulator delivers the oxygen directly to the lungs, while a mask mixes the oxygen with the ambient air as you breathe. Very different. On the surface, the answers might seem straightforward, but the truth isn't so simple. While a regulator might give faster recovery, is it okay to leave someone in the water if they're truly struggling? A boat might feel like a logical place to recover. But could staying in the water actually help your body stabilize? Today we're going to break down all of the critical decisions that divers make in even more critical situations. I'm going to give you my experience, different perspectives, and you can make your own decision out on the water. To understand my perspective, we have to go back in time just a little bit. The year is 2022. The month is April. This is 3 months after the first time I experienced very bad decompression sickness. It was a hard and grueling struggle just to get back to 100 meters. But I did, and on this occasion, I reached 102 meters. Dive itself felt incredible.
There you go.
I surfaced, breathing oxygen through a regulator, sitting on the platform, doing everything by the book, or so I thought. But as I sat there on the platform, I started to feel it again. A little dizzy, a little lightheaded. I didn't want to believe that this was happening. Not after everything I had been through. One of my fellow freedivers was there, a very knowledgeable person, over a 100 meter diver himself. I told him I wasn't feeling right, that I was feeling a little bit dizzy. He told me to just float in the water and continue breathing the oxygen. I trusted him, so I slipped into the water and I continued breathing the oxygen. And to my surprise, the dizziness went away. The dizziness was gone. The lightheadedness vanished. Just so I'm clear with the entire audience watching this video, this was the beginning of decompression sickness. Even floating at the surface provides just enough pressure to alleviate the symptoms. From that day moving forward, I made a rule to myself. No more deep dives unless I could at least float on the surface with 100% oxygen. For those that have seen some of my other videos, you already know that breathing 100% oxygen underwater can mimic a hyperbaric chamber session to a very small degree. With that in mind, even floating on the surface can simulate that to an equally smaller degree. And that very, very small degree made all the difference in my particular case. After floating in the water, my symptoms disappeared almost instantly. But it raises the question that I've often thought about. Would symptoms have eventually subsided if I had just stayed on the platform and breathed the oxygen? I'll touch on that later here in the video. What I do know is that when I was sitting on the platform, breathing the oxygen, the dizziness was getting worse as time went on. It was only getting worse and worse. And the longer I sat there, the more I felt it creeping in. The second I floated in the water, it was like flipping a switch. The symptoms stopped developing and I started to feel normal again. So here's the question, should you put a person in the water if they're struggling, even a little? And the truth is, there's no right answer. I'm just gonna give you my experience. From a medical team perspective, it makes sense that they would want to keep you out of the water. Keep you dry, put an oxygen mask on, observe you, and cater to you in a more controlled environment outside of the water. But for me personally, put a regulator in my mouth and put me in the water. Unless I'm completely paralyzed and I cannot move, I want to float in the water. When the symptoms start, it's a race to the finish line. And the finish line is very close. You can't let the symptoms get too far ahead of you. If they progress too much, you're screwed. You'll pass a threshold where getting back in the water is just not an option. And that's exactly what you want to avoid. On every occasion I had decompression sickness, dizziness, tingling, numbness, if I had even the slightest ability to move or float, I would take it because I've seen the immediate benefits of getting in the water and going underwater with it. And I've also seen what happens when you don't. Depending on where the nearest hyperbaric chamber is, you can be looking at weeks, months, or even years of recovery. Is that a risk you really want to take? One time I stayed above water breathing oxygen for 40 minutes when the symptoms started. The symptoms did eventually go away, but it wasn't the same. For months after, I would wake up with shaky hands every morning. That kind of residual effect, it lasted for months. That's why if I have the choice, I'll always choose to get in the water. But again, I understand why a medical team would decide differently. They want to monitor the situation and respond if things take a turn. I understand that. But from my perspective, with the right dive buddies and the capacity to move, the water has always been the fastest and, in my opinion, safest way to recover. So why am I telling you this? Why did Tori make an entire video talking about this? The reason is because I've been in a competition where I had just finished a deep dive and I wasn't feeling well. Knowing my history and my experience at the time, I had to be more than insistent to get up out of my seat, get them out of my way, and get to the water to put a regulator in my mouth to breathe the oxygen. That's why I'm bringing it up. That's why I'm making this video. For any lone freedivers that might find themselves in a very similar situation. Now, it's not because medical teams don't know what they're doing. It's because decompression sickness is not well understood,
especially in freediving.
And unfortunately, the world's foremost experts are not doctors. It's the people that have suffered from it, people like me. Take it for what you will, but I did find myself in a situation where a medical team was unintentionally starting to cause more harm than good. Because they didn't know my history, and they didn't have experience with this stuff. I knew my history, I had experience, and I knew my odds were better underwater with the oxygen. I'm not gonna finish this video on a downer. And I didn't just make this video to crap on medical teams that are trying to help during freediving competitions. Normally these people are volunteering, they're well educated, have plenty of experience, and all the credentials you would want in a medical team. But we're not at a place in history where this is understood well enough yet. Just like I want a robot to clean my dishes, do my chores, fold my laundry, we're just not there yet. And until we are, people like me need to share their actual lived experience so that the medical community can become more aware and educated on this particular topic. Thanks for sticking around till the end. I know this is a super niche topic and it applies to so very few people. But with my experience, although unfortunate, I feel it's important to share this subject matter with the world. My goal is to help everyone gain a better understanding of what's at stake in those critical moments when injuries like this occur. Because decompression sickness is a super time-sensitive injury. Seconds can equal years. If you haven't already noticed, I've been releasing a mini-series on decompression sickness and specific topics related to it. Please subscribe and stay subscribed as I'll be releasing a new video every week. Each one is pointed at a very specific topic related to the injury based on my own unique experience with this phenomenon. And if my audience enjoys hearing about them, I'll keep making these videos. So thanks for stopping by. Please subscribe to catch all the upcoming videos and like the video if you learned something.